But not to forget, you should always remind me. And then I will upload them on AutoClass, of course. The homeworks are going to be pen and paper. This is not a programming course. So anything else? Of course, if you have any questions, you can always write an email. I should be able to answer. And if there are no other questions for now, then I would first ask each of you to introduce yourself. I want to know who is taking the course. There are not so many people. So we can maybe start. Let's see who participated. Akif, are you here?
Do you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, so maybe you can tell us where did you graduate, when did you graduate, where are you working?
I'm graduated from our department this mm-hmm. year. I worked for 2 months at a web project, a web game, a game of my friend. So I worked there 3 months as a front-end software engineer. But now I have no job currently. I'm at my hometown. My interests is thesis ideas right now are image processing and neural networks. I guess that's it. Thank you.
Okay. So which option are you?
Which option? Computer.
Computer. Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Very well. Mm-hmm. Okay. Hazal.
Hello. Hi. I am Hazal. I graduated from master at this February, and I just started. And I just started this semester for PhD in control option. Mm-hmm. And I work at Rocket Sun for 6 years.
Okay. Very well.
Thank you.
Fatih, are you also here? If you're saying something we cannot hear, your microphone is closed. Okay, Mert.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
I graduated from electrical engineering in 2016, and previous semester I graduated from computer engineering, both in Middle East Technical University, and I started my PhD in computer engineering. And I work PhD. As a top-tier verification engineer in Turkish aerospace.
Ah, okay.
Thank you.
Okay, very well. Thanks. Mustafa?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
I graduated from our department also, but now I'm making my master in Hacettepe University. I'm taking this class as a special student. I'm also working in Auto Technocent in PRFRG. I guess that's it. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks. Furkan?
Hi, my name is Furkan. I graduated from Bilkent EE at 2019 and start my MS in year 2. And I am telecommunication options. My option is telecommunication.
It's telecom. Okay, very well. Thanks. Kadircan? Not then Metatron first.
Hello, teachers. I guess we talk about ourselves.
I asked you already.
I was switched the phone, so I missed that part.
Huh.
I'm on desktop and it doesn't have a microphone, so as you are asking question, so I turned to phone.
Okay, I see. No, we were just asking about yourself. Where are you working at?
I am making a master's in METU, and it's my, I guess, second semester.
Mm-hmm.
And I am working
somewhere.
With,
which option are you?
I'm in computer option.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm working in a signals and systems company. So that's my probably the thesis topic. And also work with Gözde Hoca.
Okay. Nazim Kerim.
Hello. I graduated 2 months ago from our department and started master in computer option. And currently, I'm working at Aselsan.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks. Onur Deniz.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
I'm currently studying at EE at Optu. I only have a couple of courses left. I have completed the computer area courses last year and my graduation project as well. I'm planning on moving on in my master's with computer science and related fields, especially natural language processing. So I want to build a foundation for those kind of subjects by taking this class. Also, before when you asked if we had any questions, I asked a question, but turns out my microphone was muted. So I have to repeat that question now, if it's okay.
Let's first introduce ourselves. I will ask you about the question in a second.
Sure.
Zeynep?
Hi, I'm graduated from TED University in 2018 and started my master's degree in our department in 2019. I'm in telecommunications option. And now I'm currently working at RocketSun as a system solution software engineer. Nice to meet you all.
Okay, thanks. Welcome. Kadircan, can you hear us? seems not Fatih.
I think both of them can hear us typing in the chat panel.
Ah, I see. I didn't look there. So they don't have a microphone, maybe. Thanks for the hint. So did you all read it? Fatih is from Aselsan, also graduated this year. Previous year, computer option. Okay, Kadıcan Havelsan. Okay, perfect. Thanks. Thanks for your inputs. Did I miss anybody? I think not. So now we can come to the question of, there was one more question. Can you say it?
Yeah, it was my question. Mm-hmm. And related to the title of this course, usually when computer science departments offer this course, it's formal languages and automata, but here it's switching. And I wondered if there's a foundational difference between this course and the regular automata courses at the computer science departments.
There's no difference. It's a historical issue, I would say. Okay. From the first professor who offered these courses. So there were two courses and the topics were distributed in these two courses. But now the main computer science course is concentrated in this part two.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Sure. Okay, if there's no other question, I can also introduce myself. My name is Klaus Schmidt, as you know. I graduated at the University of Erlangen with the PhD in 2005. And I have been in this department for some years now. And although I'm a controls person, my main PhD topic is very closely related to finite state automata. So there's also a control version of this, and that is my topic. And we also implemented a C++ library for this. And during this course, you might want to use the C++ library. I will give you a hint on the web page. It also comes with a graphical user interface. So it's about operations, computations on automata. And that's why I have no problems with teaching this course. This is my very strong background. Okay, if there's nothing else, then let's just very softly start with the first topics. Today it will be mostly informal. And then you will look at the video lecture of the second module. And this will be then the formalization of what we are talking about today. So let me start. The course is mainly about the theory of computation. And if you talk about some background on the theory of computation, it is a branch of theoretical computer science. Okay, it already says it, theoretical computer science. So this is a more theoretical topic. And what do you want to do? You want to determine whether and how efficiently problems can be solved on a model of computation using an algorithm. So what you need is a model of computation, and then you also need algorithms that work on this model of computation. If you talk about the theory of computation, there are three major branches. One branch is automata theory. It's related to the study of abstract machines and automata, as well as the computational problems that can be solved using them. Okay, so this is some model that you define in order to represent computational problems. There's computability theory, which is about the study of computable functions and Turing degrees. This means you want to find out what it means for a function on the natural numbers to be computable. So when can you expect a result and when not? And also how non-computable functions can be classified. So this is interesting. You might say if a function is not computable, then it's not computable, but no, there's a hierarchy based on the level of non-computability. Okay, so there are better and worse cases regarding non-computability, functions that cannot be computed. And the third branch is the computational complexity theory. Somebody who took a course like data structures in our department should already have heard about this to some extent. It's about the classification of computational problems according to their inherent difficulty. Okay, there are two things that you might have heard in data structures. One is algorithmic complexity. This is related to you write an algorithm and then you determine the complexity of that algorithm. And if you write a bad algorithm, then it will have a high complexity. And there's computational complexity, which looks at a problem and tries to find out how difficult it is to solve this problem. So the complexity of the problem itself, not the complexity of the algorithm that you use to solve the problem. Okay, so these are the three major branches of the theory of computation. Now, as I said, if you want to study this topic, you need a model of computation. And the model of computation means you have a mathematical abstraction of a computer, of a computing device. And such a mathematical abstraction is needed to perform a formal, rigorous study of the computation. Because if you only have a vague model, then you cannot make any clear statements. And the most common model today is the Turing machine. And as I said, this will be covered at the end of this course because it's a quite complex topic. We will work towards this topic throughout the course. Now, where does the name Turing machine come from? It comes from the mathematician, the English mathematician Alan Turing, who is called the father or founder of modern computer science. He studied abstract machines called Turing machines even before computers existed. What does this mean? I'm sure you heard about this. Alan Turing was very closely related to decoding this Enigma machine, which was a very important task during the Second World War. And Turing also invented the Turing test. Okay, so as I said, we will come to this Turing machine towards the end of the course. But for now, we will talk about simpler models of computation, just to warm up a little bit. Now, we can come to the outline of the course, which is, as I said, starting from the simpler models. First, we are going to look at deterministic finite automata. This is the topic that is formally covered in the next module. But we will start talking about it today. There are regular languages, which sort of describe the behavior of deterministic finite automata. Then we will have a more general model, non-deterministic finite automata, and an algebraic way of writing down languages, which is regular expressions. Okay, so these four bullet points, they form one larger topic altogether. Then we come to a more general class of languages, which is represented by context-free grammars. This is the class of context-free languages. And we will also see a model for this, which is the pushdown automaton. So these three bullet points, context-free grammars, context-free languages, and pushdown automata, they are again one group of a topic. And then in the end, we will look at the most general model Turing machines. We will discuss decidability, computational complexity, and a topic called intractability to determine under which conditions or which problems can be solved or cannot be solved. So now, as I said, today we will start informally talking about automata, and let's first give some background. An automaton in computer science is an abstract computing device. What does it mean? It receives an input. Normally, this is a sequence of symbols from the outside, and it provides an output. And the output is generally the acceptance or rejection of an input sequence. Okay, so you give an input sequence, and the automaton decides, is this a good sequence or a bad sequence? If it's a good sequence, then the sequence is accepted. If it's a bad sequence, then it's simply not accepted. That's the main idea behind this. Now, if we talk about the components of an automaton, how you represent it as a model, an automaton has states, and a state is something that has memory. The state remembers the relevant portion of the system's history. Okay, so the system's history, what happened up to this point now, is summarized in a state, is captured by a state. And when we talk about automata, there are automata that have a finite number of states, and there are also automata that have an infinite number of states. You will see both of them. An automaton has input symbols. These are the symbols known by the computing device. So the computing device can understand these symbols, can understand if such symbol is given to the device. Automaton has transitions, and a transition indicates a change of state depending on the observed input symbols. Okay, so you can think about it like this. The automaton is currently in a certain state. Now some input symbol arrives, and the automaton will move to another state because now the history is different. Okay, so the new state will remember the new history with the additional input symbol. There's a start state, that's just the state where there's no history, the system starts up in this state. So there were no inputs received up to this point. And there are accepting states. These are the states where input sequence is accepted. Okay, so if we reach an accepting state, then it means the input sequence was a good input sequence. Now, why are automata useful? They have many applications. They're used in many different application areas. Now, just to give you some examples, in computer science, if you look at the theoretical aspects, they are used in complexity theory. They're also used in certain applications like string matching, lexical analyzers, and compilers use automata. There is something called bot behavior in computer games, which describes certain moves that can happen in a computer game, and also parsers of XML files. They might be based on automata. In engineering, automata are also used a lot, for example, in automation and control. This is my area of expertise, using automata to model certain processes. Also in power systems, that's the case. Automata are used in artificial intelligence. They are used in natural language processing. They are used to design and also analyze communication protocols. And anybody who took a course like logic design knows that automata or state machines, they are called there, are used in sequential logic. Okay, these were just some example applications. There are many more, but this is just something to a little bit catch your interest regarding the usefulness of automata. Now, for today, I just want to show you some examples, and we will write down an informal model for these examples. Okay, in the next lecture, you will see, as I said, the formal model. The first example I want to discuss is the so-called string matching unit. What we want to do is, we want to design a string matching unit that receives a continuous stream, of capital letters and digits. Okay, what we want to do is, we want to return an accepting signal if the string EE546 is detected. Okay, let's look at it again. So we receive a continuous stream of capital letters, and we return an accepting signal if EE546 is detected. Now what I want to do is I want to write down all the form, all the components of the automaton for this example. So what do we need? Let's look at it. We need states, we need input symbols, we need transitions, we need a start state, and we need accepting states. That's what we have to think about. And now what we can do is we can maybe start with the input symbols, and then we will think about the states. And for this, I would ask for your help. So let's try to do this together. So we look at the string matching unit. And first, we define the automaton components. Okay, let's think about the input symbols. What would this be? Any idea?
Letters.
Mm-hmm. So we would have, let's restrict it, let's say capital letters. Anything else?
Numeral.
Mm-hmm. So we can call it digits. Okay, so if we would want to write it, we can write as a set. We would have A, B, C, up to Z, and then 0 up to 9. Very well. Now let's next think about the states. Which states would we expect? Let's recall, we want to memorize the history. Let me write down one state. I will call it epsilon. This is the state where nothing happened yet.
There could be the second state where the letter E has arrived, maybe.
Exactly. Another state would be the state where the letter E has arrived. This is something we should remember because it is on the way to receiving this sequence EE546. And now there's an important fact that I should tell you. The name of states is normally not important. Okay, formally not important, but it helps us to know what we are doing. So as you said, I would call this state E. Just to remember that it means we received E. Now if you found this first state, what other states could we have?
Just a continuation of the word, like E, 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 5, and so on.
Exactly, that's what I'm going to do. So another state would be EE, then EE5, EE54, and EE546. Okay. Now, what about the initial state? Now, the initial state is the state where nothing happened yet. So I would say it is epsilon. Okay, don't ask why epsilon. We will clarify this later. And about the final states. What would it be? Since the accepted sequence is EE546, I will use EE546. Okay, now here you have to be careful. Maybe you're not so much used to formal notation. The initial state is a single state. Okay, but the final states, they can be multiple. Okay, so I would write the final states as a set, and the initial state is just a single state. Okay, now we're almost done. Now we have to think about the transitions. Let me start with one, and then you can maybe help again. I will write it like this. From the state epsilon to the state E, there would be a transition with the symbol E. Are there any other transitions from epsilon?
Yes, to back to epsilon.
Yes, there will be transitions that go back to epsilon. Very good. And this would be all the other symbols.
Yes.
Okay, I can write not E. Okay, all the other symbols different from E. Okay, because these symbols, they are not useful for accepting the sequence EE546. Now let's see. From state E, which transitions would we have? Let me write one. If we get the symbol E, then we would go to the state EE. If we get another symbol, where would we go? We would again go to epsilon, because we have to restart. What about EE? If we get 5, we would go to EE5. Now, at this point, we have to think a little bit. Is there any other symbol that would be useful to some extent?
Another E would be useful again, because it still leaves us with two E's.
Exactly. Very good. So, if another E happens, then again, we have two E's back to back. Okay, actually we have three E's, but we only have to count the last two E's for our accepting sequence. And for all the others, we go to epsilon. Now for EE5 with 4, we go to EE5 4. Now let me put one more special transition. If E happens, where do we go?
State E.
Now we would go to state E. Exactly, because now we observed a single E. And if we have all the others, we would go to epsilon. Now EE5 4, if we receive 6, we go to the accepting state, EE5 46. With E, we would again go to state E. And with the others, with the other input symbols, we would go to epsilon. And now there's only one state left, which is EE546. With E, we go to E. And not E, we go to epsilon. So this would now be an informal automaton model for this string matching unit. Any questions about this? Let's go to the second example. Now I want to model a resource allocation system. So we model and analyze the user access to a shared resource. There are two resources, one and two, that can be allocated. The symbols UR1, UR2 are used if we allocate the resource. If we use the resource. Okay, so it means use R1, use R2. If the resources are freed, then we use the symbols FR1, FR2. Now we want to look at two different cases. In case one, a user is allowed to use one resource or both resources in arbitrary order. So we have to find all the combinations of using and freeing the resources. Let's try this on the next slide. First, we look at case one. Which states would we have? I'm suggesting four states. One state is again epsilon, which means no resource is used. One state is R1, which means R1 is used. R2, which means R2 is used, and R1, R2, which means both are used. for the symbols, they're already defined. We have UR1, UR2, FR1, and FR2. The initial state will be epsilon. What about the final state or final accepting states? Which sequences would you accept? Okay, this is a question which is difficult to answer because we don't know what we want. Okay, we first have to define what we want. And in principle, it would be most useful if after using resources, they are freed again. So I would use the initial state also as accepting state. Let's look at the transitions. There are two possible transitions from epsilon, because I can use resource one or use resource two. So with UR1, I would go to the state R1. With UR2, I will go to the state R2. Now for the state R1, what can happen? The symbol FR1 is possible. And we would go back to epsilon. Or what is also possible? UR2 is possible, because after using the first resource, I can also use the second resource. And then I would go to the state R1, R2. For R2, we can do the same thing. If R2 is possible, the transition goes to the initial state. UR1 is possible, and we go to the state where all the resources are used. And finally, if we are in the state R1, R2, which means both resources are used, any of the resources can be freed. So if FR1 happens, if we see this symbol, then we go to the state R2. If FR2 happens, we go to the state R1. Any questions up to this point? If not, then look at this picture, and we want to read the second case. Again, we look at the resource allocation, but in case two, both resources can only be used if R1 is used first. If both resources are used, R2 must be freed first. Okay, so it's like we only use R2 if we really need to. Otherwise, we should use R1. Okay, so it's maybe like R2 is more expensive. Now, if we look, what would change in the model? Or let me ask this first, what is not going to change?
Transition from epsilon to R1 wouldn't change.
Okay, now I can just mark this in a different color. So you're saying this transition will change.
Yes, that will change, but the transition left of it would change. The transition from epsilon to R1 wouldn't change. Sorry,
did it I wouldn't change exactly. It's okay. So the red one will change.
Yes.
Because we say we cannot first use R2. We first have to use R1. Mm-hmm. So that's the first bullet point. Now we looked at what changes. What else would change in the transitions?
That transition from R1 R2 to R2 would change because it frees R1 first.
Exactly.
And there would be no. Sorry?
Is this correct? Let's read again. Before we fix this, if both resources are used, R2 must be freed first. Mm-hmm. So if R2 should be freed first, this transition should be removed.
But in the transition, R2 is being freed, right?
Exactly. So you want to free R2 first.
So it is a correct transition for this case. So it should not change as I understand.
No, we say we should free R2 first.
Yes, I agree, but that marking with does it mean we should remove that transition, right? Red
we should remove the transition. Are removed in case two. Now I know what you mean.
I think the left one should be removed,
right?
Because there are no more the state R2, and the transactions with and R2 states are must be removed.
No, you're completely right. I asked the question what should be kept before, so this was in my mind. We are looking at what is removed, and that's this one. We are not allowed to free R1. So this should be removed. These transitions are removed in case two. Okay, let's check again. We said we are not allowed to use resource 2 before resource 1. Okay, so this transition from epsilon with UR2 to R2 is not possible. And we are not allowed to free R1 before R2. So the transition from R1, R2 with FR1 is also not allowed. And the interesting case is that the states don't change, the symbols don't change, the initial state and final state, they stay the same in these two cases. We just had to change the transitions for this. Okay. And that's actually all I wanted to tell you for today. Are there any questions?
Shouldn't we remove two more transitions because we never can use R2 only, and there are transitions from R2 to epsilon and R2 to R1, R2.
Now, this is a topic we will discuss in the more formal discussion. Okay, so this is not necessary to remove them because we will never go there. Okay, so this doesn't contribute to what the automaton models.
Okay, thank you.
And we will later see an automaton property that covers exactly this. Okay. Anything else? Okay, if not, then thanks a lot for your attention. I will see you again in the next question and answer session. But if there's any question, you can write an email anytime. Okay, thank you for now. See you. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for the lecture.